course title is Dynamics of Machinery. I am PVJSN Murthy, Associate Professor in Mechanical Engineering Department. This course is a continuation of our previous course, Kinematics of Machines, which you have studied in your second year. This is a course, Dynamics of Machinery, is an extension of the previous course which you have studied in your second year, second semester, that is Kinematics of Machines. Okay, so let me first explain the difference between the Kinematics of Machines which you have studied in the earlier course and the course which you are going to study this semester, that is a Dynamics of Machinery. In the previous course, that is Kinematics of Machines, we have covered the motions of a linkage, velocities, displacements in a mechanism without considering the forces caused those displacement, velocity and accelerations. In nutshell, I can tell you that we have bothered about only the motions in the mechanism without considering how those motions are obtained, the cause for its motion and its forces. Then coming to the Dynamics of Machinery, here once again we bother about motion, but here we would like to pay our attention on the force which causes that motion and the force analysis. Okay, let me repeat once again. The course KOM which we have studied in the previous course and the course which we are going to study in this semester, the present one, is DOM. So you can see the basic difference is like this. We have studied in the KOM course the motion without considering in a mechanism, that is without considering the force which causes that motion. But whereas in the Dynamics we are studying the same motion but by considering the forces that causes that motion. Here I will give you a simple example to understand the difference of KOM and DOM in a simple words like this. Say you asked your father, I want a bike. I want to have a bike to go for my college. You asked it, isn't it? So naturally, because of the nucleus families and today, whether they are affordable or not, the parents are going to provide you that necessary amount to provide that bike. Say in a one case, the father has earned the money. How he earned doesn't matter. That means it is not in illegal way, what I am saying. How hard he worked, you are not bothering, and he has given the money to you and you obtained your bike and you enjoyed the comfort and riding and everything with the bike. This is case 1. In the case 2, the father has earned the money and given to his son that money and asked to purchase a bike, but meanwhile he said how he earned the money, what extent of hard work he performed to obtain that money, and then how he is providing that money to you to buy a bike. So that difference you can identify in both the cases. Case 1 also you got the bike, in case 2 also you got the bike. In case 1 you are not bothered about how your father struggled to get that money, but in the case 2 your father has given that complete inputs how he worked to get that money. This is a simple example. Here why I have given this example is, in the KOM course you are bothering about the displacement in the mechanism. Okay, And in the DOM also, you are bothered about the displacement in the mechanism or velocity and accelerations in the mechanism. But the thing is, in case of KOM, we are not interested to study how that displacement or motion is achieved with the help of what type of force and what it is causing anything. And whereas in the DOM, you are bothering about the forces results that motion and the displacement. That is the basic classical difference between your KOM and DOM, isn't it? Now, let us see what are the contents we have in this dynamics of machinery and what are the course objectives. That we will see in another two slides. The course objectives are like this. The first objective is, what is gyroscopic force, what is gyroscopic couple, and what is its effects on a moving bodies. That is the one of the objective to know what is gyroscopic effect, gyroscopic couple, and what are its effects on the moving body. That is the first one. The second objective is, what is friction and what is the application of friction in developing a components like clutches, brakes and dynamometers. So to provide enough knowledge to design certain devices like brakes, dynamometers and clutches, how you can apply the basic principles of friction. That is the second objective. The third objective of the course is to analyze the force analysis in a slider crank mechanism, isn't it? That is the third objective. Then the fourth objective is to understand the function and need of a device called flywheel, and a governor, and their performance. What is the basic difference between a flywheel and governor, and their operational characteristics we would like to study in the fourth chapter. That is another objective. Then coming to the another fifth objective is balancing of rotating masses as well as reciprocating masses, and the causes for this unbalance, how to take care about the unbalance rectification by some techniques. That is the another objective. And the last and very important objective of this course is studying of the vibrations. The vibrations are in general one of the main and prime cause for to damage your mechanical elements, isn't it? So there the natural frequencies, damped frequencies and their evaluation and their further rectification mechanisms are going to be studied in the vibrations. So these are the six objectives of this course, Dynamics of Machinery. Okay. Now, these are six units in your syllabus. That is unit one, which covers the gyroscope. Unit one, which covers the gyroscope. Unit two covers clutches and brakes. Unit 3 covers flywheels. Unit 4 covers governors. Unit 5 deals with the balancing. And finally, Unit 6 deals with vibrations. So let us spare 1 minute on each topic. What is its importance and how we would like to utilize this in our day-to-day life for designing or to analyzing the various systems existing in the real world. So the first one is a gyroscope. It is a very new word to you. The rest of the words you might have heard it, like clutches. Day to day, our life, we use vehicles. You are, whether you know the performance or not, but you are aware of working of clutch and brake. Flywheel, may not be very sure you are aware of completely, but you might have seen such a wheels. Governors, balancing, vibrations. These are not a new terminology, but this term is a new term, gyroscope. So what is this gyroscope and where we use the gyroscope and what is its need in advanced engineering application, isn't it? So gyroscope is a word derived from two Greek words. One is gyros and another one is scapier. These two words has given a word called gyroscope. So anyhow, we will be discussing immediately now in detail the gyroscope. So I am not explaining very detailed this part. Anyhow, I will discuss in another couple of minutes. Now let us see clutch and brake. We are always saying friction, friction, friction in mechanical members, and the friction is a negative tool. It's not true. Without friction, you cannot expect you will be moving from one place to the another place by the road transportation. And at the same time, we always bother about the increasing the efficiency of the systems by minimizing the friction. But at the same time, there are certain occasions where we invite the friction to serve the purpose of your necessary equipment. Such a things are clutches and brakes. Clutches and brakes. You might have observed it in some of the movies like this. The vehicle is going, okay. And suddenly there will be another vehicle is crossing to your vehicle without following any road rules or anything. To safeguard yourself, you want to apply a brake. Sometimes you apply the brake will properly work or may not properly work. The malfunctioning of the brake may be because of so many reasons. One may be the linkages are loosened. The other one is brake shoes are not properly engaged, or the friction material which is used in the brake is not up to the quality. Similar clutch. So when we use the clutch, what is the function of the clutch? That we will discuss in detail later part. Just I will give you a small example for what is clutch or how this clutch works, isn't it? Say, let us say you have in your home a water tank completely filled with water. At your kitchen, you have one tap which you will be using it for requirements of the kitchen. Suppose if I don't have a control between tank to this tap, if there is something happened wrong in the tap, or if I have not taken enough care in the controlling the water in the tank, so there will be a problem. Suppose an intermittent one, if I put a device, as and when I need it by operating that, then I get the water. Or if I want to control the water, so I can control that intermittent device. Similar here in the clutches, a clutch is a one which is acting a transmitting device between the wheel and the engine. So the engine is continuously delivering the power and the wheels also continuously using the power. But there are certain occasions where we need not require the power, even the engine is running. So at that moment, so if you disengage the clutch, not engaging the clutch, if you disengage the clutch, then the power will be generated, but the power will not be transmitted to the wheel. So that is a device called clutch. The clutch and brake both will work on the principle of friction. So that we will discuss in the unit 2. Coming to the third one, flywheel. What is this flywheel? How it works and what is the basic principle involved in it? A flywheel is nothing but a simple wheel with a huge mass. Why I am using the word huge mass? Because it works on a principle of moment of inertia. So you are aware of it, mass momentum of inertia is given by mk square. I is equal to mk square, where m is the mass, k is the radius of variation. I is mass moment of inertia, which is equal to m into k square. M is the mass and k is the radius of variation. You can see here, if you have more mass, you will have more I. If you have more k, then it will be very beneficiary because it is a k square. A product of A and B with B with a square is always a favorable situation. But I have a certain limitation for radius of variation. If I increase the radius of variation, the size of the wheel is going to be increased a lot. So there will be a certain limitation over the k. Then I can go for a heavy mass. Okay. Then the wheel radius of variation can be limited to certain extent. So a huge mass, if I keep it, then I get more mass moment of inertia. And the flywheel works on the principle of this inertia principle, so that I can have more amount of energy can be stored. So that is the another one where you design your systems with heavy or high quantity of moment of inertia. Okay. Then coming to the fourth chapter, unit 4 deals with governors. Governors, isn't it? Flywheel and governor, it looks similar nature, but there is a major difference exists between these two. When we come across that course, that time I will explain it. At this moment, what is a governor and what is the importance of governor, I will tell you. Almost you are all having some experience with your vehicles, driving the vehicles. So you are moving on a road with a 40 kmph, let us say, and your friend is crossed you, or your time is running over, you have to reach a certain location as per the given scheduled time, so you have to increase your speed. Then what you will do, you will immediately rise for the acceleration. So when you rise it, what happens? The speed of the vehicle increases. How it increases? It increases because when you are rising it, you are opening the throttle valve so that the more amount of fuel is entering into the engine cylinder, so that more power will be developed and you will get that acceleration. It's very simple thing, everybody knows it, isn't it? Similar, take an example, like we have certain systems where there some power is generated by different means, like a mechanical, electrical or hydraulic or whatever it may be. So the power developed is supplied to somewhere to serve the purpose of various equipment to run. Say, if you are under constant load, then there is no problem with what amount of power you generating and what amount of power you are using. But if there is a supply demand gap comes, that means your requirement is more, but it is delivering less quantity, then performance of particular equipment is not right. In such a situations, what we have to do, similar to the previous example I have given, rising your bike to increase your speed and to control the fuel quantity, here also we have to operate by means of not manual involvement, some mechanism, some methodology, we have to operate the constant speed. For that, a device which we use a governor, okay? So, that is the governor operation. Then, the fifth unit, it covers balancing. What is balancing? What is rotating masses balancing? What is reciprocating masses balancing? Why we have to go for balancing? How a balancing can be done? So, for a classical example, here I have shown one rail wheel where heavy mass is placed at this location. You can see here heavy mass is placed. Why this heavy mass is placed is, this is a reciprocating masses balancing. This reciprocating masses balancing portion we'll discuss. If you don't put such a heavy mass at one location, then you don't have a perfect contact between the wheel and the rail. So for that, we'll provide intentionally some amount of heavy mass here is a part of a technique under balancing. So there we'll discuss so reciprocating masses balancing as well as rotating masses balancing. And the last unit is a vibrations. So some of the universities are offering this course as an elective because it have its own importance in mechanical engineering. The reason behind it is majority of our components in real life will fail due to the vibrations. So, unless you know the vibration phenomena, the vibration behavior and the vibration characteristics, we cannot control the vibrations. So, here I have given a schematic part. Three sketches are shown. Bodies are vibrating. In one case, the body is simply swinging up and down. So, that is called longitudinal vibration. These are the three vibrations. One is longitudinal vibration and another one is transverse vibration. Third one is torsional vibration. Longitudinal, transverse, torsional. Just have a simple example like this. Take a body which is hang with some elastic member and given a initial displacement and then it will continuously move up and down. This is called longitudinal vibration. Then you take another one, that is transverse vibration. You just imagine there is a beam, a cantilever beam, and just give a displacement. So it will vibrate up and down, that is called a transverse vibration. The third one, torsional, take a disc and give a twist. Then it will be swinging clockwise and anti-clockwise. These are three basic vibrations, longitudinal, transverse and torsional. So these vibrations are going to be studied in our last unit, that is vibrations. So today's lecture, I will stop with just giving an introductory part in the unit 1, that is what is gyroscope and what we are going to study in this gyroscope and how the word gyroscope was coined in 18th century. So the contents in this first unit are what is gyroscope and how we will represent the gyroscope, representation and the couple and its gyroscopic effect, and these gyroscopic effects practically how we are going to observe in these three devices, aeroplanes, ships and four wheelers, isn't it? So let us first focus on how the word gyroscope is derived. How the word gyroscope is derived. Before I discuss this gyroscope, I will tell you, during 16th, 17th, 18th century, the scientists have performed a lot of experiments on a simple toys to know the basic physics principles involved in the motion and to know the planets' movements and whatever the laws you are aware of it, Kepler laws and all these laws related to displacements and motions. Actually arrived from simple observation from the concepts of toys. So we are all aware of it, how the Newton has invented the basic the gravitation when he was sitting in the bottom of a tree, an apple was fallen from the tree. He thought, why not it can go up, isn't it? Yes, naturally, why it should fall only bottom, why it cannot fly up? That was the thought. Similar, the people have observed certain things, a simple, very very simple. Of course, now this technology world, you may not be aware of it, otherwise in childhood, we played with a toy called a top. So a top is given a simple rotation, then it continuously rotates. Okay, so the toy will be revolving simply with a stable nature like this. But as the speed decreases, it falls, isn't it? So you can see this is a toy. So this is a top. This is a revolving. But at the end of the speed, it falls like either this way or this way. This was one of the observations made by the scientists. Okay, and they developed certain laws. Similar, here, this gyroscope is a word coined from two Greek words. One is gyro and another one is scopion. What is gyro? Gyro means circle. Gyro means circle. Scopion means to look at or to watch. That means a circular motion watching, or circular motion observing, or a circular motion is spinning motion is nothing but a word called gyroscope, isn't it? So a gyroscope is a simple device which is used for either measuring or maintaining the orientation based on a simple principle called angular momentum, isn't it? A gyroscope is nothing but a simple device which maintains or which measures the orientation based on the angular momentum principle. Okay, so in the next lecture we'll continue the angular momentum principle, how we can apply on the this gyroscope to orient or to measure its orientation, isn't it? You can see the animation here. It is nothing but actually a gyroscope, which we'd like to discuss for another 5-6 lectures. Thank you.